Welcome. Hi. I'm Jamie, by the way, for any of you who haven't met me or don't know me. And welcome to Attracting Women from the Inside Out, which is a strangely ambiguous kind of title for a workshop, but it kind of made sense to me anyway. And we're going to be spending a couple hours doing some exercises, exploring some stuff, doing some experiments, and I'll introduce you to some ideas and concepts in terms of wherever you are in terms of your journey of having relationships with members of the opposite sex and having a happy life and having the sort of things and experiences and people and feelings that you can, that you want to have in your life. And just so I can get a sense of you guys, by a show of hands, have we got anyone in the room? Well, I know we've got at least one who's like a ninja superstar playa style-y playa. Oh, we've got at least one or two joining us later as well. Well, have we got anyone in the room who's, you know, kind of, who have we got who's sort of been working on this stuff for a while, sort of the whole business of meeting women, kind of doing that formally, you could say. And by formally, I mean saying, okay, I'm not just going to go out to the bar on a Friday night and get loaded, and when I'm drunk enough, I'll talk to some girls. I'm like going to take a look at developing myself. We got some, by show of hands, people are doing that? Okay, cool. Have we got anyone who has been kind of reading around this stuff but hasn't actually gone out and done anything yet, hasn't gone out and, you know, talked to girls and that sort of thing? Anyone? Okay, great. And if I ask the question, have you got game, is there anyone who doesn't know what I mean by got game? Because I got to tell you guys, when I first got to this part of my life, well, and just before I say, is there anyone who the idea that this is even something you could explore, develop, get good at, has only just occurred to you recently? Like this, you didn't even know that that was possible. Yeah, because that's where I found myself back in the early 90s. I had two buddies. One of them was called John, and one of them was called Andy. And these guys were amazing with women. And to make matters worse, they were both not very good looking and not very big. They were kind of scrawny. They weren't even as tall as me, and I'm like 5'8" or something. But they were just box office. And it was, I guess, 1992, 93, around then. And I would go out with them, and I would drink heavily, because that was part of my approach. I'd drink heavily and get as drunk as I possibly could. And I would watch what they did, and I couldn't figure it out. I couldn't figure it out. And I tried a bit of modeling, tried to, hey, Sharon, do you want to just prop the door open slightly so if people show up, just slightly, just a couple of inches, just throw Sasha's hat in the door, and just to keep it open. That's great. Just take a seat, Sasha. These guys had game, but I didn't understand what it was they were doing, and I didn't understand how it was they were doing it. And I just assumed there was something different about them, because my background was, I was horrible with women. I went to a boys' school, like I spent from when I was 12 to when I was 17 with 250 horny blokes, which is not a good way to learn. Yeah, I'm sort of reminded of that this evening. And I didn't get a girlfriend till I was 19 years old, and I basically, so I effectively got married to her. We weren't married, but we were in like a total monogamous living together relationship for 4 years. Then she and I split up. I hung out for probably 3 months, had a few quick flings, then got in another of those long monogamous relationships. And at the end of that one, she left me. She went off and had an affair with someone else, and I was like gutted, and I was really ashamed, and I knew that something hadn't been right, but I didn't know what it was. So I thought, I'm going to get this sorted out. This was in like 1995 or something. Then I went out again and used my usual approach of getting really drunk, and I met some girls, and I met one, I got married, and I was married for like 9 years, and then she left me. But in the interim, in 1996, I read an article with a guy called Ross Jeffries. And Ross Jeffries was a guy who was using some technology called NLP to teach guys how to seduce women. And my ears pricked up. I was like, oh, that sounds interesting, because I'd had the idea a few years earlier of figuring out what my buddies John and Andy did. And I thought if we could teach guys how to do this, I would be minted. But I couldn't figure out what they did. And even worse, I didn't really try that hard to figure out what they did, because I knew there was something different about me, which meant that I couldn't do what they did anyway. It wasn't what, I didn't think it was what they were doing. I thought it was who they were being. And it turns out on one level I was right. On another level I was wrong, but on one level I was right. It was about who they were being. So I got interested in NLP, but I was married by then. And so I started looking at it and using it to get an edge in business. And I quit my job. And it's interesting, I quit my job. I had friends who had quit their jobs and become contractors or set up their own businesses and that sort of thing. And I thought, yeah, I could see how they could do it, but I knew I couldn't do it. And then I went on an NLP course in 1998, just a weekend course, went on a two-day course. And the guy who was running the course, it was really cool actually, because I'd been on presentation skills courses and that sort of thing. The guy who was running the course, he came out to the front of the room, there was a bunch of people in the room, he just sort of stood at the front of the room and he started talking. Didn't have any slides, didn't have any projectors, just started talking and telling stories and got us to do some exercises and to do a bit of this and to do a bit of that. And it really opened up my mind. A couple of weeks later, I quit my job and started on this adventure in terms of having my own business and that sort of thing, and did a variety of things. Tried some things, failed at them, that sort of stuff. But I was still married, and I was still not having the kind of relationships that I wanted. Like, my marital relationship was sort of fading. And 3.5 years ago, wife left me. And all of a sudden, I'm like an NLP trainer. I have one of the better-known NLP companies in the world. I've got all this stuff about hypnotic language and that sort of stuff out there in the world. And I thought, now is my chance. I've got all these ace NLP and hypnosis skills. I'm going to get out there, and I'm going to make up for all the girls I didn't have sex with when I was between the age of 14 and 19. So I thought, that's my plan. That's what I'm going to do. I had a problem. I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. I had these amazing skills, and something deep inside me was saying no. Saying, don't do that. That's not the way to do it. And I don't think it was my integrity per se, because I would have, you know, it wasn't like, I can't do it because it's the wrong thing to do. It was like, my neurology wouldn't let me do it. I was like, that ain't right. See, I don't know if you guys have heard of this, but we've got a conscious mind. We also have an unconscious mind. Your conscious mind pays attention to things at one level, and your unconscious pays attention on an entirely different level. And you can think of our conscious mind as having been around for maybe between maybe up to about 60 or 70,000 years. That's how long we've had language. That's how long we've had conscious minds. And we haven't had logic until the last 1,500 years. Did you know that? Logic is a relatively recent invention. It's an invention. It's not real. But our unconscious minds have been around for millions and millions of years, maybe half a billion years, something like that. And our conscious mind is capable of tracking things on one level, like paying attention to maybe between 5 and 9 things at once, but your unconscious pays attention to things at an entirely different level. And when I thought that it was because my friends were different, there was something different about them that meant they were good with women, when I thought there was something different about my friends, that there was something different about them that meant they could go and start their own business or whatever it might be, but I couldn't, it was because there was stuff going on at my unconscious level that was preventing me from doing it. Beliefs about myself, beliefs about my world, beliefs about who I was. But here's the interesting thing. See, well, actually, before we get into that, I want you to do an exercise. Just stand up for a second. And what I want you to do is to go and meet a few people. So to go up and just shake hands with them and say hi to them. But you've got a secret mission. Here's your secret mission. I want you to imagine that you want something from this person. Like later on in the evening, you want to ask them for like 50 quid or something. Someone you don't know. You're going to try and borrow 50 quid from them. But here's the thing. You can't let them know that you're going to want to borrow that until later. You can let them know later maybe. But for the moment, don't let them know it's about the 50 quid. Just pretend you want to meet them and that sort of thing. And start to be the kind of guy that they would, you know, that you think they would like to loan 50 quid to later on. Okay? So go and do that. Maybe meet two or three people. Spend 30 or 40 seconds with each, just saying hi and, you know, connecting with them, that sort of thing. Go to it. Okay. So what were some of your experiences of that? What was it like to have kind of a, you know, something you wanted to get, but keeping that kind of hidden and interacting like that?
I was much nicer than I normally am.
Interesting. Can anyone vouch for that? What else? What
were? A lot more sort of talking and asking a lot of questions, like that kind of questions.
Uh huh.
Kind of fake, just making conversation.
Interesting. What else?
I was kind of guessing. I was kind of guessing what I'm going to say next.
Interesting.
And last, I wasn't tracking that well, like what actually happened to the other person. So it's kind of okay. What I'm going to say, not what I'm going to feel.
Interesting.
Yeah, you're more in your head. You're trying to like strategize, you know. Yeah.
Interesting.
You're
interesting.
You don't care what we're saying.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay, so here's what I'd like you to do next. I want you to stand up and meet some guys again. Meet at least the three guys you already met, but with a different frame. I want you to assume that they actually already really like you. So they think you're a cool guy. And you want to find out if they're the kind of person you'd like to get to know better. Now, here's the thing. You can't judge a book by its cover. So I know a number of the people in this room, and what I know for a fact, I know absolutely to the heart of my being, you all have amazingly cool things about you, amazingly interesting things that as we get to know each other, people are going to go, wow, I would have never thought that just from looking at you. Things that you don't know about the other people. So what I want you to do is assume that the other person thinks you're a cool guy and find out if they're the sort of person you'd like to get to know better. Just find out if they're the kind of person you'd like to get to know better. However you do that, and that may just be by chatting with them, or it may, you know, I'll leave it up to you. Just find out if there's someone you'd be interested in getting to know better. Before you do that, it might be worth thinking about, what kind of people am I interested in getting to know? Who do I enjoy spending time with? What sort of qualities do I value in another human being? What are the kind of things that are important to me? And then go find out who's got them. Okay, go to it. All right, let's get back into one group. Take your seats, please, gentlemen. You can't sit down. It's so funny. I'm used to working with NLP groups, and so these are people who are very kind of connecty, sherry. And I've got a bunch of guys who are doing their best alpha stuff, and it's like, sit down, guys. Fuck you. I'll do what I like when I like. Right on. I'm loving it. So, how was that different?
Less awkward.
Less awkward.
Sasha's kind of saying it's less manipulative this time.
Interesting.
Yeah, there was a lot more relaxed gaps, you know what I mean? Where no one seemed to want to talk in the gap. They were just like, let's just let this gap be. And when it's forced, everyone wants to fill it straight away. And it gets awkward when it doesn't get filled, and then everyone senses it and they all, you know, split off.
Sure. What else?
I felt we connected on a different level.
On what level was that, would you say?
Just a more social, more just not needy sort of.
Yeah. Sure, please.
When I was observing your first time around, you all seemed quite sexy, you all seemed distant. But as soon as you told me to relax, you started to get closer and stuff. And so I think you all looked like, yeah, I'm actually interested in engaging in this conversation with you.
It was harder to break it up.
Yeah.
It was harder for me to get you to sit down. Finally, I had to shout, sit down, to get you to break it up. Interesting. So I don't want you guys to jump to any premature conclusions about how this may relate to guys trying to get something they want from women. It's just a thought. You understand? I didn't want to use the thing you had to get as sex, so I thought 50 quid instead. But if you substitute one for the other. Dave.
We don't get an ask for directions from Kelly, because he was going to call me and ask me for directions.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
go for it, man. Go for it. And it, for you guys, if you need to do anything, if you need to go to the loo, if you need to get out, do what you need to do. But I thought that would be a good starting point, because the interesting thing is, so I started exploring this stuff, and I started exploring this domain of how to meet women, how to get good with women. Because like I said at the beginning, I was horrible at it. I would tense up. I couldn't even walk up to a woman on the street or something like that without being all shaky and all freaked out. It was totally sketchy. And that wasn't me consciously. Consciously, I really wanted to meet women. But my unconscious had a bunch of programming in it telling me that it was not okay to do that. And where had that come from, do you suppose? What sort of places do you think that programming might have come from? From childhood, boys' school, yeah. From the media, from movies. Experience with girls in general, from parents, from friends, from all kinds of places. It wasn't stuff I'd chosen consciously. But we've all got that stuff to a greater or lesser degree. Manage. Okay. And so I started to think about it, but so I started to explore this stuff, and I realized something amazing. A bunch of the stuff that was getting taught by various companies as sort of tips and techniques of how to build comfort with women and things to do, little mini adventures into the future, you know, and there were names for all these things you could do. I went, I used to do that when I was drunk. I used to isolate when I was drunk. I used to... Not all of them, but many of those things, when I was drunk, I would do them. And no one had taught me to do them. So I thought, I wonder if this is something that's in there naturally, in everyone, in every guy. See, here's the thing. If you believe in the theory of evolution, we've evolved over thousands and thousands and millions of years. We go back many thousands of generations. And a quick evaluation will reveal to you that each of those generations, there was one man and one woman involved. So we're 50% male experience and 50% female experience. It's all in there. It's all in there already. Now, here's the thing. It's not that there aren't things you can learn from the outside that can improve what you do, cool things you can do that will make you more effective and that sort of thing. But what I've become more and more interested in is how do we tap into what's already there, who you really are? Because it seems to me the more I connect with who I really am, the more women seem to connect easily with me. It's funny, I'm not really a big bar guy. I mean, we'll go out to the bar afterwards and we'll have some fun, but that's not my favorite place to, you know, to meet girls and stuff. I like cafes and the street and coffee shops. But I woke up this morning and I had a crisis of confidence. I was like, oh my God, I'm teaching this seminar tonight. I haven't been out to a bar talking to girls in a whole week. What if I'm rubbish at it or something? Because there's a part of me, sure, that's going, who am I to be sitting in a room teaching guys? I haven't had sex with 2,000 women. Surely I have to do that before I can teach a room full of guys how to meet girls. Because, well, have you ever heard that quote? It's by a woman called Marianne Williamson. It says, our deepest fear is not that we're inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we're powerful beyond measure. It's our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. You see, there's a model of how human beings are. If you see a little kid, little babies are very, very confident. They have a natural kind of energy that shines out of them. And you can think of that you, that you were all babies at one point, as being like a diamond. Welcome back, Dave. As being like a diamond. Just perfect, totally authentic, totally open, totally shining. You know, if you take a baby, you guys are a bunch of cool guys. If we brought a baby in here, you'd be 50% kind of repulsed because it's a baby, and 50% going, ah, and because babies make people shine. It's this baby thing. It's kind of weird. So we've got that naturally within us. All the domains, and the cool thing about babies, they ask for what they want. They want something, you know about it. They're not going, huh, what do I have to do to get this and that and the other? They let you know right away. And they're amazing. And babies don't realize that they're anything other than completely fantastic. But here's what happens. We learn. And we learn all kinds of things, all kinds of good things, because what we are, in essence, is learning machines. We're amazing learners. See, here's the thing. Whenever I travel to London, I use sat-nav now. I tend to use sat-nav, but I used to use the A to Z. Now, the A to Z is a map of London. It's a map of London, but it's not London. It's just a map. London is far too big to be contained in a book that fits in my glove box. It's got far too many things in it, far too many qualities. It's got buildings, it's got people, it's got millions and millions of things that could never be contained in the map. A map's useful for navigating it, but it's not London. Well, here's the thing. Do me a favor, just touch your nose. Just do it. Isn't that amazing? Okay, here's the thing. If you don't think so, then you haven't been around me for long enough. But here's the thing. There was a time when you couldn't do that. When you didn't know how to do that. There was a time when you didn't even know what the word nose meant. Where you didn't even know that that was your hand. Well, that's my hand, but that your one was yours. You didn't know it was your hand. You didn't know that there was a relationship between the, and you learned it. And you learned it fast. And you learned it without going on any courses or reading any books. You learned the way that your different parts of your body, you built a map of you, of your body, and of your world, and of the important people in your world. And the first time you heard the word milk, you didn't even know what it was. It was just a sound, not distinct from your mom coughing or anything else. But very, very quickly, you learned to associate that sound with that warm, nourishing, yummy liquid. And you did that with all the words that you've ever learned. And see, your body is designed for a world of things and experience, not for a world of words. But you can translate the words I'm saying so quickly into things that make sense to your deeper body mind that it happens automatically. So what you did was you built a map of you. And that map of you contains all the ideas that you had about yourself and the world. And each of those ideas, if you imagine like a shining light, like a light bulb, each of those ideas is like a cobweb. Maybe an idea that it's not okay to get angry, or it's not okay to do certain things, or that you can't do this, or that you can't do that, or that you shouldn't do this, or that you shouldn't do that. And what we get is like a layer. Welcome. We get a layer of shit around the diamond. Okay? Diamond's still there. There's like a layer of horse poo around it. So what we then do is we build a personality. And the personality goes on like nail polish on the outside of the horse poo. Nice metaphor, huh? Just stay with me on this one. So the diamond, that's who you really are, okay? That shining, amazing light. The horse poo is who we fear we are. And the nail polish, the personality, is who we pretend to be. Which gets us where? Well, here's where it gets us. What's your name?
Tim.
Hello, Tim. I'm Jamie. Which gets us where? Well, we show the personality, because what we don't want anyone to see is the horse poo. Because that's who we fear we are. Like, oh, I mustn't let them see the shit. Oh, I'll pretend everything's great. Da, 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 da. What we actually need to do is just clear that away so that the light can shine through. The light of who we really are. The light of our desires. You know, here's the thing. The things that you want, in a while I'll probably ask you, what do you want in this area of your life, which I'll call love life or relationships or, you know, women or however you want to think about that. I'm going to ask, what is it that you want? And some of the things you want, I'm guessing you'd be happy to share with the room. There may be other things that you want that you mustn't let anyone know. Oh my God, if they found out that I like to do that, they would stone me in the car park. And yet, pardon me? Yes, or both, preferably in the right order. So we pretend. We pretend to be other than who we are. And nowhere is this often more the case than when it comes to meeting women. So we pretend to be someone who we're not. And what do women say? They say, just be yourself. If we were to ask 1,000 women for advice on men of how to be, you know, how to be more successful with women, they say, just be yourself. Well, who do they mean? They don't mean this. They mean be who you really are. Be honest. Be authentic. Would you have something to share, Dave?
The discussion was happening about the same thing.
Yeah. Just be yourself. So let's do an exercise. Well, actually, just before we do. So the A to Z isn't London. London is far more amazing and wonderful than could ever be encaptured in the A to Z. I've had experiences in London which wouldn't fit in the A to Z. So you've spent your life building a map of you. And when you think of yourself, when you think of who you are, it's the map that you're thinking of. When you think of things that you may have described or perceived as limitations, oh, I can't do this, oh, I mustn't do that, oh, I wouldn't be able to do this. You're talking about your map. But who you are is so much more than your map of you. You know, the first course I went on, first NLP course I went on, the guy said, you're capable of far, far more than you think you are. And I've added to that, I say, you are far, far more than you think you are. And I assume that whatever your desires are, whatever it is that you want, the reason you want those things, you know, whatever it is that you want, and I don't care what it is. I mean, I care, but I don't mind. Whatever it is, there's other guys in the room who don't want that. So whatever it is that you want, those desires have been placed in your heart or wherever they live because they are specific to you. They're part of who you are. They're an expression of what's important to you, your values, your sexuality, your drive as a human being, your masculinity. They're part of who you really are. And it's okay to want what you want. So here's the thing. There's a guy called Michael Neal, another great NLP trainer, wrote a book called You Can Have What You Want. And in it, he makes a really cool point. He says, once you give yourself permission to want what you really want, whatever that is, and become okay with getting it, then it's actually really easy to get it. It's a lot easier than you might expect. But here's the thing. You know what people go for? Instead, they go for what they think they can get. They don't go for what they want. They go for what they think they can get. Because they think, well, what I really want, I could never do that. Oh, that would be too hard. That would be too difficult. Da, 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 da. So they go for what they think they can get. You know what? What you think you can get, there's way more competition for that than there is for what you actually want. What you really want is easier to get, believe it or not. So I started doing an experiment. I'm rather partial. I'm going to share some details of my sordid life with you. I'm rather partial to threesomes. So I've started going into bars and going up to pairs of women and saying, hey guys, quick question. I'm feeling in kind of an adventurous mood this evening, so I thought, good night for a threesome. And you two have a kind of fun, playful energy, so I thought I'd start with you. And we take it from there. Now, I haven't had any threesomes as a result of doing that, but it feels great because it's very, very authentic. And I get a great response 80% of the time. Very positive response from the people I'm saying that to. Now, I'm not suggesting that you say that with whatever your version of a threesome is in order to get great results in terms of getting what you want. However, how you think it's going to turn out is probably not how it's actually going to turn out. You know, I've got a friend who I suggested something like this, suggested that he experiment, because he's very good with game, got a whole bunch of tactics and stuff. I said, why don't you just go up to women and as an experiment say, hey, you're kind of cute. If I buy you a drink and we have a chat and we get along okay, will you come home and have sex with me tonight? Just to find out what happens. And he did that a few times, but before he started, he was concerned that he was going to get his head kicked in and thrown out of the bar. And that never happened. In fact, he got extremely positive results. Why? Because he's being authentic. Now, again, I'm not suggesting that you do that as a way to develop excellent outer game skills, whatever we might call that. I'm suggesting that you might like to experiment with that as one of the ways to really let yourself know at the deepest level that it's okay to want what you want. That it's okay to want what you want. As long as it's legal. You know, if what you want involves doing things that harm other people against their will and that sort of thing, then I hope you get the full penalty of law for that. But as long as it's within the bounds of legality, I suggest you do that just to find out what happens. And just to find out what would have to happen for you to give yourself permission to do something like that. So here's what I want you to do. Don't worry. I want you to choose. Hey, Caddy, welcome. Hiya, Steph. Take a seat anywhere. No, join the group, please.
Hello.
Yes, please. Please, welcome. There's one chair for each of you sitting across from each other. It's very beautiful. So you've come at the perfect time. What we're going to do is we're going to get into pairs, and you're going to ask the other person that you're in a pair with, what do you want in terms of however you want to characterize this, your love life, your relationship life, your experiences with women, however you want to characterize it, what is it that you want? And here's a question I'll ask, that just because sometimes people kind of go, oh, I don't know what I want. Is anyone like that? I don't really know what I want. Yeah, no, well, that's not unusual. However, I was talking about this stuff on Radio Leicester the other day, and the presenter said, well, I don't know what I want. She's married, not in the context of this stuff, but in the context of something else. And I said, well, often when people say they don't know what they want, they do actually know. It's just that they've got some, you know, obstacles to allowing themselves to believe that they can have it. So I said to her, what would you want if you didn't have to be unhappy about not getting it? And she went, what? I said, never mind. What would you want if you knew that you couldn't fail? And she said, I'm not sure. I said, well, what would you want if you knew it was okay to fail? And she went, well, I'd start up my own holistic health center. I said, so that's what you want? She's like, oh, yeah, definitely, but I can't do it. So she knew exactly what she wanted, but she had some limiting beliefs about her ability to do it, and so she pretended instead that she didn't know what she wanted. She knew. And I assume that on some level we all know what we want, but we've sometimes got some things in the way that prevent us getting it. And sometimes it's that stuff there. So yeah, that's what you're going to do. You're going to get into pairs. You're going to ask the other person, what do you want? And then once they've told you a little bit about it, you're going to ask them, how will you know you've got it? And then I want you to ask them another question. Ask them, what will that give you? And you can even ask that several times. Would you guys like a quick demonstration of this? Yeah? Okay. Would anyone be willing, is there anyone who'd like to find out a bit more about what they want to maybe get closer to having it and make it easier and more fun and enjoyable? My coaching sessions cost about 2,300 quid, but this would be free, of course. So if there's anyone who has something that they think that they might want, but they'd like to clarify, just and would be helping the whole group as well. I've got Jonathan, come on up. Give Jonathan a round of applause, please. Yeah. So welcome.
Thank you.
So, Jonathan, what in this area of your life, however you would characterize it, what is it that you want?
I guess my confusion at the moment is that I sort of see it as
another latecomer.
Welcome.
I see it as two different things. I've got like a longer term goal, but at least one much shorter term goal, and yeah, sort of trouble reconciling the two at the moment. The longer term one, I want to get married and have a family. In the shorter term, I don't know what I want specifically out of that person, so I understand I'm going to have to do things in the meantime to find out, i.e. meeting a lot of women.
Okay, cool. Now, it's interesting, a little bit of NLP for you. I really pay attention to what people say in the first kind of 30 seconds, and often the first thing out of their mouth. One of the presuppositions of NLP is that people will tell you everything you need to know right away. So does anyone remember what the first thing Jonathan said was? I said, what do you want? And he said, I guess my confusion at the moment. Interesting. So, and that would explain a lot, because here's the thing, once you know what you want, it's a lot easier to get it. And one of my assumptions is, and this won't apply to you guys, I'm sure, but I deeply believe this, is people always get what they want. We are all getting things the way we want them to be right now. Which is kind of a powerful frame, because if you think, okay, I'm getting what I want, then you can ask yourself, what would have to be true for that to be true? So I asked Jonathan what he wants. He said, I guess my confusion at the moment. Now, he didn't use that terminology, he didn't use that tonality. He said, I guess my confusion at the moment is, and then he told us a story. But if Jonathan wanted his confusion, if that's what he wanted, then he would be in the process of getting it right now. So that's interesting, right? So if you were to go beyond that confusion, what would you want if that was behind you?
I would want to meet and get to know a lot of women, or enough to get a better idea of what I was looking for in a long-term partner.
Okay, and I hear you. But to me, when someone really, really wants something, how do they sound? What lets you know that this is something they really want? Enthusiasm, I think, yeah. Because my sense is that this really makes sense to you on some level, that this is what you want. But there's another level on, like, how exciting does that sound?
What I just said?
Yeah.
Yeah, it kind of does have a dull sort of background to it. Coming, like, straight from the heart, I guess, what I really want is fun and good times.
Oh, okay, now that looks more real to me. So, that, excellent. How will you know you've got it? What'll you see? What'll you hear? What'll you feel that'll let you know that you've got fun and good times?
The first thing that came to mind was I'd be lying on my bed on a Saturday night and my phone would have been ringing off the hook all day. But I would choose to just stay in because I could.
Okay. Well, what else will let you know?
I will have choice of women in my life.
Mm-hmm.
I will have people I can call and be sociable with in whatever shape and form that takes.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll always know that fun is just around the corner.
Fun is just around the corner. And sometimes here, too. Sure. And the other question I want to ask you is, what will that give you that you wouldn't otherwise have, having fun in your life? Keep breathing. Breathing's good. Breathing's okay. This is, by the way, just on an aside, one of the things people will often do, if they're feeling uncomfortable feelings or feelings that they don't feel comfortable with, they'll stop breathing. And our body needs air. Breathing is good. Breathing is useful. So, and has anyone in here ever suffered what's referred to as approach anxiety? Well, yeah, like every one of you, pretty much. That is one of the things people will often do when that hits them is they'll freeze up and they'll stop breathing. Breathing is good. That is my main presupposition of NLP. Keep breathing. Breathe and feel stuff. I was doing an experiment today. I was just going up and approaching women and noticing what feelings went through my body while I did it and just keeping breathing into them. Now, I didn't have anything in mind of what to say, so I was saying some real goofy, stupid stuff, but that was great because then they had some you know, a variety of responses and all kinds of feelings kicked on. And I kept breathing and feeling and accepting those feelings. And it's very, very interesting. It's something, you know, you have feelings for a reason. They're there to give you information. They're there to give you motivation. They're there for a variety of things. So breathing is good. So yeah, what will that give you that you wouldn't otherwise have?
I think it'll give me a feeling of calmness, a feeling of contentment, and a feeling like I don't need to strive to sort of fulfill a part of my life that's unfulfilled and get something that I don't have right now.
Interesting. So you won't need to strive to fulfill something that's unfulfilled and get something that you don't have right now. Well, that's good. That's good. What will that give you that you wouldn't otherwise have? Now, interesting, another NLP thing for you guys is people always answer the question physically before they answer it verbally. So did you see what Jonathan did? I said, what will that give you that you wouldn't otherwise have? And he just went... started breathing easy, centered. Interesting.
Yeah, the answer I was going to come out with would be calmness.
Mm.
It wouldn't be so much an active feeling. It would be sort of an absence of a more negative feeling that I perhaps do feel at times at the moment.
Okay, so it would be calmness. Just, again, another NLP point. You see where Jonathan's putting stuff. He said the something, he was talking about, I would not have the feeling that I would have to strive for something that da-da-da-da-da. That was where, in the same location that he put the married partner and all that stuff earlier, when he was talking about those feelings that he didn't like, he put his hands in exactly the same places where he was talking about going out and meeting lots of women. So interesting. What would happen if you just put that to one side and allowed yourself to have fun and excitement? Yeah, that seems different, doesn't it? Yeah. What's your experience like that, when you have that sense of calm as well available to you? With a sense of, you know, fun and enjoyment.
I guess it's just like riding on the crest of a wave. It's not trying, it's being rather than, yeah, being rather than striving.
And what would that give you that you wouldn't otherwise have?
I think it would be a massive element of happiness in my life.
Well, that sounds good. So we'll come back to that. But that's what I want you guys to do. I want you to get into pairs and ask the person you're working with, what is it that you want in this area of your life that we might call love life or relationships or sex life or women or whatever it might be? What is it that you want? How will you know you've got it? Then once you've got an answer, and look for some enthusiasm, because if people are giving really, well, I will really feel that I have choice and selectivity with women and da-da-da-da-da-da-da, that's not what they really want. That's what they've figured out that they want. But when someone's telling you about something they really want, they'll be like, yeah, man, that's what I want. You can tell. You can tell. So it'll be like that. There'll be that. You'll be able to know. How will you know? You'll know, right? Because they'll be showing you. Then you're going to ask, how will you know you've got it? What'll you see? What'll you hear? What'll you feel that will let you know you've got what you want? And then once you've got something there, you're going to ask them, what'll that give you? Feel free to pull your chairs in and join our little intimate circle here. Come on. Yeah. Just join the horseshoe. Well, you know, I feel very comfortable with mixing metaphors. So what sort of things do you guys want? What is it that you want? Because here's the thing. If you can say it out loud in a group of people, your chances of acting on it are much less. Here's the thing. If what you want is a hidden dark secret, your chances of getting it are somewhat reduced. Don't you think? Because if it's a hidden dark secret, you know what that means? It means that you're scared of other people's opinion. It means that you're worried about other people's approval. And approval seeking doesn't just apply to approval seeking from women. It's also approval seeking from guys. I spent the first 6 weeks of this year skiing in Canada. And I had this as like a dream. I want to go skiing for 6 weeks and take 6 weeks off work and it's going to be great and da 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 da. I got out there and I realized part of it, part of why I'd wanted that, was just bragging rights. And I felt really let down by myself because I didn't think that I didn't recognize that approval-seeking aspect of myself. But it hit me when I'd been out there for about a week, and I was kind of like, oh, this isn't as great as I had expected it to be. Because it's one of the things, well, we'll get onto that in a second. So what sort of things do you guys want? You don't like to say.
Be more relaxed in a relationship.
Be more relaxed in a relationship.
I want to be comfortable everywhere.
I want to be comfortable everywhere. Now, is that comfortable everywhere or comfortable everywhere? Well, and I hear you, and I can relate to that, and I can connect with that. And my sense is that mushrooms are comfortable everywhere, and that there are sometimes, like I love this martial art called Krav Maga with a passion. It's an Israeli martial art. It's a complete freak show. It's like completely animal, and it's amazing, and I adore it, but it ain't comfortable. Comfortable is not a word that I'd use. You know, I'm getting pounded in the face by someone, and I'm trying to tear his nuts off or whatever. It's not comfortable, but it's really fun. It's exciting. So are you sure you want to be comfortable everywhere?
I mean, like, comfortable in being myself and expressing myself.
Oh, I get that. Yeah. How will you know you've got it?
Because I went through the anxiety. I'll be going out with my mates and having a laugh and stuff.
Okay. And so you'll know that you've got it because you won't feel those uncomfortable feelings. What will you feel?
Be more happy.
And what'll that give you?
Give me a lot more. I'll stop missing opportunities, and I'll be more able to live the life I want to live.
So you stop missing opportunities and be more able to live the life you want. And that makes sense to me. What will that give you once you've stopped missing opportunities and more able to live the life you want to live? What will that give you that you wouldn't otherwise have, do you suppose?
I don't know.
Oh, yeah. And is that okay with you?
Yeah.
Okay. And if that were to happen overnight, like there's this question I just love, which is, if there were a miracle tonight as you're asleep, and when you wake up tomorrow morning, everything's the way you want it to be, how would you know that a miracle had occurred? What would you see? What would you hear? What would you feel? What would you believe? What would you experience that would let you know that a miracle had taken place? So what would let you know, Pete? And you woke up in the morning.
But like I said, I won't have any negative feelings. So I'll be more able to help other people, I think, as well.
Which is great, you know, contributing. The interesting thing is the way our brains work is when we say to ourselves, I'll know because I won't feel those negative feelings. It's kind of like a no smoking sign. No smoking sign has a picture of a cigarette and then a big line through it. Not that. But the problem is, to even know what that means, you need to imagine smoking, right? You need to imagine a cigarette. And in order to understand what not having those uncomfortable feelings means, you got to think about those uncomfortable feelings. And once you think about them, you start to have them a bit. Do you feel what I mean? And so what I'd invite you to do is just to start to explore. We haven't got time to go into it in depth right now. But just to explore what kind of feelings you'd like to have. Because my guess is you've been an expert on the sort of feelings that you didn't want to have until now. And so it might be worth thinking about what kind of feelings do you want to have? Because an absence of feeling is not what you want. I know you might think you want an absence of feeling, but feeling is good. Feeling is good. It's just about what feelings you do want to have. So, okay, what sort of other things do people want?
Ultimate freedom of self-expression.
Ultimate freedom of self-expression. And how will you know you've got that?
First of all, I won't be blocking for what I want to express. It would be about wanting something and just going for it.
Wanting something and just going for it without blocking it. And what would that give you?
Well, I feel that it's like it's about my mission here. Actually, expressing who I am, and this will give me actually the feeling of peace on the inside.
Feeling of peace.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's here's what I'd like to offer you guys. Because I talked in the marketing I was writing for this, I said, the five master keys for something or other. What was it? The inner game master keys. Well, I've been working on them all week, like sort of refining them. Now there's only four, but I really want to share them with you because two of them sort of collapsed into one. So the number one key is own your desires. Really own them. Say, you know what? This is what I want. And I'm okay with that. And it's about going for what you really want, not what you think you can get. Because there's nothing. A psychologist once said to me, you can never get enough of second best. You can never get enough of second best because it's so unsatisfying. So you always need to try and get more of it. And that's the structure of addiction. That's the structure of, you know, whether someone's alcoholic or drug addict or sex addict or hooked on pornography, hooked on shopping, hooked on work. They're trying to get something with a second best way of getting it. You can never get enough of second best. It's ultimately completely unsatisfying. And, you know, if you want to see what being a drug addict does, just go and check out some people who are trying to hustle for crack on the street. Not good. So number one is own your desires. And that's about being okay with getting what you want. I'm running a course next weekend called Authentic Attraction with NLP. And one of the things we're really going to be drilling into there is, okay, what do you want? How will you know you've got it? But what do you really want? Not what do you, like, remember when Jonathan was up here and he was giving us a very logical answer to the what do you want question. You know, well, I want this and that and the other. But it didn't feel like something that he wanted, or it didn't look like it felt like something. And when he actually started to get in touch with what he really wanted, it was like, yeah, that there was more energy to that. You can see it. Well, a lot of times people don't let themselves get in touch with that because they think they need to have it in a certain way, or they've got to do it by according to this plan or whatever it might be. But here's the thing. Once you get in touch with what you really want and allow yourself to, you know, to see that and experience that, then it's easier to get it. And once you know what you want, it's then a matter of answering the question, okay, so what stops you? You know, how is it that you don't already have that? What is it that's been stopping you until now? And there are all kinds of things that, you know, can stop you. If you live in a tiny village in the middle of Gloucestershire and what you want is to be going out with supermodels every night, you may need to move to London or LA or to a slightly bigger village in Gloucestershire where the models hang out. But what often holds people back, well, I made a list actually of the kind of things that, the obstacles that hold people back. And then I lost it. Well, somewhere there is a list. And here's the weird thing. Fear of the consequences of success. This is a big one. Sometimes fear that if I get what I want, then something bad will happen. Or if I get what I want, then it'll mean something bad about me. Like I'm not a good guy. Or all my friends will be jealous of me and they won't want to hang out with me anymore. I know a guy who was very, very wealthy in the 80s, multi-millionaire, mansions, all the thing. He said it was a real problem for him. He said because he would go down the pub with his mates or he'd go up to dinner with his mates. If he picked up the tab for the dinner for everyone, they'd be like, flash bastard. If he didn't pick up the tab for everyone, they'd be like, tight bastard. And a lot of people kind of, they aren't consciously aware of it, and yet at an unconscious level, they've got those sorts of things coded in, that it would mean something bad about me, or something bad would happen as a result of it. I was coaching a guy once. I said, what do you want? He's like, oh, I want a mansion, and I want this, and that, and the other. He, you know, spent hours meditating on it, describing it in detail. I said, okay, well, what would that get you? And I got him to step into, you know, what would happen as a result of that, and he was kind of like, oh, yeah, it's really brilliant. Yeah, it's fantastic. I love it. It's fantastic. Totally incongruent response, right? So he wasn't like, wow, it's amazing. I love it. He's like, yeah, I've never been so happy in my life. Turns out, he'd actually had that a couple of times before. He'd become very wealthy. Then he got fired and pilloried and really bad stuff had happened twice in rapid succession. And so at an unconscious level, his nervous system had it coded in that he shouldn't be successful, because bad things would happen. So consciously, he wanted to be successful. He was putting all his energy into it, but his unconscious was holding him back. And it's what I call the hidden handbrake. It's like trying to drive with your handbrake on. If you've got stuff floating around in your unconscious that's stopping you from getting... Like, let me ask you a question, genuine question. If I could give you just a paper bag with 10,000 pounds in it, would you want it by a show of hands? Okay, so most of you, in our society, you pretty much got to be crazy not to want a brown paper bag filled with 10,000 pounds. As long as you know it's not marked notes and that sort of thing, that you're not going to get in trouble. Because we live in a society where money is highly symbolized. Highly symbolized. So it's not like someone offering you a bag of spoons. A bag of spoons is just like a bag of spoons. A bag of money has all kinds of things that it's symbolized. What else do you think is highly symbolized?
Sex.
Sex, beautiful women,
status,
highly symbolized. So we have all sorts of things in our minds hooked up to it that aren't the things itself. And here's the thing, I've done lots of work with people who have everything going for them in their life in terms of making money and all that sort of stuff, but it's not happening. And it's not happening because they've got the hidden handbrake on, because they think either it would mean something bad about them, or that, you know, money is the root of all evil, or whatever it might be. Well, it's exactly the same with women. It's exactly the same with becoming a guy who is skillful with women, who's good with women, who connects with women well. It's exactly the same with all of this. With relationships, too. I mean, how many of you know someone whose parents divorced acrimoniously? Yeah, sure. So relationships have a bunch of that stuff coded up to them as well. And if it's floating around at your unconscious, there's at least the chance that it's going to be messing with you. And it's like driving with the handbrake on. So let me ask, in some area of your life, by a show of hands, have you put in a ton of energy and it seems like you should be doing better than you are and you can't figure out why you aren't getting what you want? Yeah? Sure. It's often because the hidden handbrake's on. But there's another thing which I call the unwritten value, which is familiarity. As human beings, we like what's familiar. And part of owning your desires is saying, okay, I'm willing to have that, which means I'm willing for things to be different. But here's the other thing, and this is big news. We live in a society where we're told that we need to get stuff and status and experiences and money and all this sort of stuff in order to be happy. It's the structure of modern marketing. Is if, you know, I'll be happy when? I'll be happy when I get the car, I'll be happy when I get the house, I'll be happy when I get the girlfriend, I'll be happy when I get the fivesome, I'll be happy when I get the whatever it might be, you know? And it's not true. It's typically not true. I heard someone say, I can't remember who it was, they said, if you take someone who is happy, well-adjusted, self-motivated, self-actualized, and they get a stroke, and they're a paraplegic, quadriplegic, a year later, you'll have a happy, self-actualized, positive, and quadriplegic. If you take someone who's miserable, unhappy, generally pissed off and resentful, and give them $10 million, a year later, you'll have someone who's unhappy, miserable, pissed off, and generally resentful with $9.5 million. The stuff you think is going to make you happy ain't going to make you happy. Hate to break it to you. It may be great and fun and all sorts of good stuff, but if you want to be happy, now's the time to start. Because here's the thing, you know this, well, I'll get to that. So key number two, be who you are. Be yourself. But not the you that you fear that you are. Because a lot of guys goes, but if I be myself, she'll see me for the total fucking loser that I am. And da-da-da-da-da. Not talking about that self. I'm talking about the real you. The you that shines. The you that is not ashamed of who you are and what you are. The you that's naturally there. See, here's the thing. We come from thousands of generations of people. And each of those people, the 500 million sperm that competed for egg fertilization rights, each one of those sperms won the sperm Olympics each time. And we come from that, from like all the people who were dorks and didn't know how to get girls or didn't know how to get guys or didn't know how to survive and that sort of thing. they died. They didn't reproduce. They got filtered out of the gene pool. So the fact that you're here is qualification. You're amazing. Like, I'm not trying to convince you that you're amazing, because it's of no issue to me. You know, some of you guys will probably never see you again after tonight. Some of you I will. But you're amazing. I know that you're amazing. It's not a matter of opinion to me. It's the fact that you're here means that you are. The fact that you're here means that you come from good stock, who managed to get you here in one piece. They managed to survive to mating age and have kids, going back thousands of years without a single interruption. So that means you're amazing. And so the only, see, here's the thing. My friend Richard Wilkins runs an amazing program, actually, called Broadband Consciousness. Completely mind-blowing. Anyway, more of that later. Richard was this multimillionaire who, he got wiped out in the late 80s property crash. Completely wiped out. Went from being a millionaire in a mansion with a fleet of Ferraris to being completely bankrupt, living in a bedsit. His family left him. And he was suicidal. And he was down the pub. He'd called his brother, and he'd heard that if you told someone you were suicidal, you were less likely to do it. So he told his brother, and his brother took him down the pub. And he heard someone down the pub say, "Oh, so-and-so, he'll get there one day." And he started thinking about it, and he realized he had been there, been in the place that most people characterize as there. He was wealthy, he had it all that sort of stuff. And he realized he hadn't been happy. And he said a light got switched on inside of him. He went and worked in hospices for the next 6 months with people who are dying from cancer. And he said he saw more happy, smiling, laughing, cheerful people dying of cancer in the hospice than he saw out in the world on a day-to-day basis. Because these people got it. They got that it doesn't matter what you've got. It doesn't matter what, you know, so much, you know, how much you earn and all this stuff. What matters is who you're being. And that you is inside you all the time. But the problem is that most people have to wait till there's a disaster, like terminal illness or loss of a loved one or something terrible going on in their life, before they go, "Fuck it, I'm just going to be myself." And his point, which I think is a really good one, is why wait? Why wait? Because you know who the cool you is, but you know, if you're anything like me, you're scared of what'll other people think. Oh God, what'll happen if I just go around being a, you know, big, tall, poppy, you know, shining kind of person. It's kind of not what people are used to. It's not the status quo. But it is very attractive. Now, there's other stuff you can do as well. There's quote-unquote outer game things. Like, it seems to me really important that you get your posture handled. It seems to me pretty important that you have good voice projection and things like that. That stuff can be worked on. But who you are is already in there, and who you are is amazing. So, to me, that's tip number two. Be who you are. And the other thing is, this is the coolest thing of all. Who you are doesn't need anything. Like, doesn't need anything. Really doesn't need anything. Who you really are doesn't need anyone's approval. Doesn't need to achieve anything in particular. Who you really are is amazing. Fully actualized, fully present. Doesn't need anything. Doesn't need any approval. Doesn't need to get anything. People can feel that. When you don't need anything from them, they just seem to want to give stuff to you. Like, check this out. Just put your hand out for a second. I'm pushing. And what's your name?
Kush
is pushing back at exactly the same pressure, pretty much. He doesn't even need to think about it. His neurology automatically adjusts and balances to push back at exactly the same pressure I'm applying. When you need something, people can feel it, and they lean back to the extent that you're leaning in and needing something. They can feel it. It's at a deep neurological level. But when you realize that you don't need anything, you really don't. This is not about practicing super non-needy phone game or whatever. It's like really knowing that you don't need anything. You really fucking don't. It's all good. I mean, breathing is good. Oxygen. Yeah, I'm all in favor. But, you know, you don't even need that. It'll affect your, you know, being alive thing, but that's okay. You're all going to die anyway. Not tonight, hopefully, but, you know, sooner or later. You know, we're on a timeline. And that's worth knowing, too. Because whatever it is that you've been scared of doing until now, whatever that might be, whether that's approaching beautiful women or starting your own business or telling someone to go fuck themselves or whatever it might be, whatever your bold goal is, there's going to be a time when you can't do it. So don't wait, because courage is really powerful for developing confidence. In fact, when you do courage, when you do something that requires courage, see, I hear a lot of people say, well, I'll wait till I've got the confidence, then I'll do it. It doesn't work. You do it, and that develops the confidence. Courage gets turned into confidence. It gets transformed. So be who you are. What's number three? I can't remember my master keys. Oh, I was telling you about the things that hold people back. Do what you love. Do stuff that you love doing. Get on purpose. The program I'm doing next week, one of the things we're going to be exploring is how you can get on purpose and get on purpose fast. Because just like we all deep down know what we want, we all deep down know what we love doing and what we're here to do, or at least can find out. And part of it, part of your purpose, I guarantee you, is about being who you really are. Because that's how, if you're not being yourself, then it's really tough to figure out what it is you're meant to be doing. When you're being yourself, being true to yourself, being who you are, then you start to find out. And it doesn't necessarily make sense. From a business perspective, it makes very little sense for me to be running this session and the workshop next weekend. But it's definitely the right thing for me to be doing. I can feel it. I haven't been given the rest of the plan. I would love to have downloaded a complete 10-year plan with a financial analysis and a strategy and all that stuff. But what I got was run a workshop for guys. So I'm like, okay, what next? I'm like, just run the workshop. So that's what I'm doing. And I know that at least some of you have something that you've been thinking, yeah, I'd really like to do that, but. And the but is limiting beliefs. Limiting beliefs about yourself, limiting beliefs about what's possible, limiting beliefs about the world, limiting beliefs around what other people will think. But here's the thing. The limiting beliefs, they're just in the map. They're not in you. Like, well, I'll tell you a story. There's a rule of thumb that I got. There's something we'll be doing next weekend as well. It's called sleight of mouth. Sleight of mouth is conversational belief change. I did some sleight of mouth with Kat. Do you want to tell them, just so they'll know I'm not just bigging it up?
I've got to say this. This guy, I was going across to the States to do a fairly big technical presentation. At the time, I'd done quite a lot in the past. But this was bigger to people at a higher level. And it had kind of been gnawing at me a little bit, a little bit more than these things have done in the past. So I had a chat with Jamie about it, and he spent a little bit of time with me. And literally in 5 minutes, he sort of turned me from sort of feeling, you know, bad, nervous, anxiety about the whole thing. This was weeks before. So sort of I came out of the coffee shop, and Sasha was there as well to see it. But basically, I came out of this coffee shop, big smile on my face, feeling really confident about it, and went off and gave this presentation, and it went really, really well. And it felt good as well.
Cool.
But literally, you're talking about 5 minutes it took.
Now, and that was very cool, and it doesn't always take 5 minutes, but here's the thing. Whatever your limiting beliefs are, or the beliefs that you've perceived as having limited you until now have been, they're not about you. They're in the map. They're in the map. Here's the thing. My friend Richard, he says, the map is like a script. Who are some of the best actors in the world? I don't know. But if you give the best actor in the world a shitty script, it's going to be a shitty movie. Okay? So your beliefs about yourself, they're not even true. They're just ideas that you learned in one way or another. But here's the thing. If you recognize that it's not you, it's the script, you know what that means? It means that you're not the script. There's a you. Even if you're thinking a belief or something like that, or thinking, oh, I could never do that, or whatever it might be, the you that's thinking that is not the belief. You may be going, yeah, so what, Jamie? It's profound. We'll come back to it. Or as I often say on courses, if that doesn't strike you as completely amazing, you haven't understood it. So do what you love and recreate your reality. Now here's the thing. We're walking around in a reality that's created by our sensory systems and our mental maps and models of the world. And it's not reality. It's a model that we each carry around within us. And some of it's very, very individualized, like the things we got told by our individual parents or teachers or whatever. And some of it's more generalized, the societal rules for how we get along and that sort of thing. But it's not reality. I know it seems real. Because, you know, I was saying that when you hear words, there was a time when the word milk was just a sound, but you learned it so thoroughly that now, you know, if you hear the word, it gets translated into something your deeper body mind can understand. You don't even have to think about it. You're doing it automatically with the words that I'm saying now. You're translating them into images and sounds and smells and feelings. And the other one, images, sounds, smells, feelings, tastes. You're doing that automatically. Your unconscious does it. It takes about a 30th of a second per word. And it happens so fast that you don't even pelf that it's happening. But it does. It runs smoothly and uninterruptedly. And that's how we create our experience of reality as well. And so it seems real, but actually it's reinforced by all the things we've heard and all the things we've seen and all the experiences we've had. Our brain's always going, where have I seen this before? Where have I seen this before? By the way, how many of you heard me say the word pelf about 45 seconds ago? Sharon did, Graham did, you two did. You guys did. How many of you didn't hear it? It's okay, show of hands. I said the word pelf in the middle of a sentence. I said, happens so quickly that you don't even pelf that it's going on. And for half of you, your brain just went, yeah, fuck it, makes sense, I guess. And so your unconscious chose not to present it to your conscious mind because it would have just interrupted the flow of thought. See, your unconscious is making decisions about what gets allowed into your perception from moment to moment. So your experience of reality isn't reality. It's the reality that your unconscious is presenting to you based on the experiences that you've had in the past. Some of them good, some of them less good, some of them empowering and supportive, some of them, you know, not so useful. And so one of the things I love doing is using this set of linguistic tools called sleight of mouth to help people change their beliefs about the world and about themselves and about the way things are. Because here's the thing. And again, for my friend Richard Wilkins, he says, the way you can think of it is life's a sausage machine. Life's a sausage machine. If you put, stay with me on this one. If you put beef into a sausage machine, what kind of sausages are you going to get out? Get beef sausages. If you put pork in, you'll get pork sausages out. If you put garlic in, you're going to get garlic-flavored sausages. So, if what you want to get from your, whatever you call this area of your life, your love life, you know, is a sense of calm and fun, then that's what you need to put into it. That's what you need to put into it. Going out and doing a bunch of structured, not very fun stuff that's stressful isn't going to get you a calm, fun love life because you're putting the wrong stuff into the sausage machine. If you want to have just amazing, pleasurable experiences and fun and all that sort of stuff, and you're putting into it structured tactical plans and that makes you feel bad, you're not going to get fun and enjoyment and pleasure out. It's just the nature of the beast. It's not that that stuff can't be useful. It's that you need to put in the emotions that you want to get out. You need to put the right stuff into your sausage machine. I thought the metaphor of sausage machine was particularly relevant given the subject under discussion. Made me smile even before I started talking about it. But yeah. Yeah, well. Yeah, hot dogs all around. So. In terms of recreating your reality, one of the things you want to start looking at is what sort of feelings do you want to have in that reality? Because you know what? All people want is feelings. That's all people ever want. Anything you buy, anything you do, anything you experience, anything you dream of, the reason you want it is the feelings it'll give you. Is there anyone who's skeptical about that? Because oh, by the way, I meant to say at the beginning, the stuff that I'm saying is just my opinions on stuff. It's not true. It's just ideas. If you find them useful, great. If you don't find them useful, just throw them out. It makes no difference to me. Because I don't need anything, except when I do. But But if anything I'm saying you think is just bullshit, call me on it. Say, dude, that's just not true. I'll probably agree with you, but if anyone doesn't think that all we ever want are feelings, let me know and I'll see if I can prove it to you real time. Does anyone doubt it? Well, that's the thing. If all we ever want is feelings, then we need to put in the feelings that we want to get up front in order to get them. Because we think we need to get the thing in order to get the feeling, right? I'll be happy when I've got the whatever. I mean, women are... My heart goes out to women because women have the best marketing and advertising brains on the planet, get paid billions of dollars each year to try and get women to hate themselves, to hate the way they look, to think that they're not good enough, to think that they're ugly. I said earlier that I had a crisis of confidence this morning. I was going, I'm like, I haven't been out in bars every night this week. Who am I to teach the seminar? So I went out this afternoon. I did my experiment of going up and talking to women and just noticing what feelings were going on inside. And so the opener I was using with this one person was, how old are you? Because I have a great deal of trouble telling how old women are. And so I ask them. I go straight up and I say, hey, quick question. Can't tell how old you are. You could be anywhere from 15 to 30. If I ask you, will you tell me honestly? She goes, how old do you think I am? I say, I'm guessing 21. She goes, I'm 20. So we ended up having a chat and going for coffee and that sort of thing. And she was lovely, but she thinks she's ugly because she's got an entire marketing machine aimed at making her think she's ugly so she'll buy more shit to put on her face and more clothes and that sort of thing. No one's out there saying to women, you're amazing, you're beautiful, you're wonderful. And as a result, lots of women don't like the way they look or they have some part of their body that they hate and that sort of thing. And that's too bad because I love them. But they've been told you'll be happy. They've been told that they'll be happy when they get the right makeup and get the right boyfriend and get all that sort of stuff. It's bullshit. Today is practice for tomorrow. If you're practicing putting off being unhappy, if you're practicing putting off being happy, you'll get better at it. If you're practicing putting off being calm and peaceful, you'll get better at that. If you're practicing putting off having fun and being joyful, you'll get better at that. So you want to recreate your reality so that you're putting the stuff that you want to get in at the front end. If you want to be having fun with women and with this area of your life, then put lots of fun in. Don't put lots of discomfort in. There may be some discomfort along the way, but have fun with it. So anyway, so let's do another exercise because I've been ranting for about 7 minutes now, at least. What's the time anyway? 22. We're good. You all good or do you need a break or anything? All good? Okay. So here's what I'd like you to do. I want you just to choose something that is... like some feeling, just think of some situation where you tend to maybe tense up or get uncomfortable or something like that. Something that you may have been experiencing as a blockage or a problem until now. And just notice where you feel it in your body. And just point to where you feel it. Okay. Just get a sense of what kind of sensation it is. Is it moving? Is it still? Is it got a color? Or is it dark? Is it spinning or is it, moving back and forth? How big is it? Just get a sense of that feeling, that sensation. And then what I want you to do is say thank you to it. Just inside your head. You don't have to act weird and say thank you on the outside. Just say thank you to it. Keep breathing, by the way. But say thank you to it. And notice what happens. Just say thank you once. You don't need to sort of thank you it into submission and get it into a thank you death lock. Yeah, thank you, motherfucker. And just once will do. And notice what happens. What happened when you said thank you to it?
Scary.
Cool. Could that be useful? Yeah. See, often feeling... What else? What happened when you said thank you to it? I'm going to pull you up on something. I'm not resisting it. Okay. And what happened when you stopped resisting it?
It was natural. It wasn't anything.
Cool. Did anyone else have that experience that it just changed all of a sudden? See, feelings just want to be felt. They've got some kind of message sometimes or something they're trying to tell you, like, run away or whatever it might be. But they don't necessarily want to make you do the thing that they've got in mind. They just want to let you know that that's one of the options that's available. And if they don't think that you've heard them or felt them, if they don't think that you've got the message, they'll keep giving it to you. And if you try and push them down, you know what they do? They do what Kush did. They push back. And the harder you try and push them down, the harder they push back the other way. Because feelings are an expression of your unconscious. Feelings are your unconscious mind communicating with you. And your unconscious mind kicks ass. Your unconscious mind is so powerful. Your unconscious is running the show. So you don't want to get in a fight with your unconscious because you'll lose. You really will. Your unconscious always wins. So it's really good to start developing a good relationship with your unconscious, getting in communication with it, connecting with it, because it's part of you. And it's a part of you that's existed for far longer than words have, for far longer than language has, for far longer than our sensible, logical minds and our society and that sort of thing. Your unconscious has been in development for millions of years. Yeah? Absolutely. I think, to my mind, acceptance and self-acceptance is really, really powerful. And I think saying thank you is a way of accepting the messages that your feelings are giving you. Absolutely. In fact, let's do that. Put your feet flat on the floor for a second. You know, good hypnotic subjects often put their feet flat on the floor. And I just want you to try a little affirmation. Just say to yourself, I accept myself exactly as I am inside. And notice what happens. It's okay, it's perfectly safe. Or just say to yourself, I accept myself exactly as I am on the inside of your mind. And keep breathing. And notice what happens. Keep breathing. Lots of people stopping breathing all of a sudden. So what happens when you do that?
Much more peaceful.
For some of you, I'm guessing it's sort of chilled out and relaxed. You feel a bit of chaos. Oh, so here's what you do. To that chaos, just go.
It's on the top of sausages that built me up.
Yeah, not long now. Say thank you to that chaos and notice what happens.
That's cool.
Cool. So what other experiences do you have when you just say, I accept? Did anyone have kind of objections? Kind of, if I accept myself as I am, then I will, you know, be a loser and da-da-da-da-da. Anyone have that?
I have trouble with it just in general. I don't think it's like, you find it hard.
It's hard,
yeah.
And so when you said, I accept myself exactly as I am, what happened?
I found it hard. When saying that, I found it hard to really dig at where I need to dig to.
It does make sense, but what happens if rather than needing to dig, if you just say it to yourself inside your mind and notice what happens? So don't try and make anything happen, just notice what happens. What happened?
Again, I'm still getting a sense of the stuff that I can't bring up to the surface to accept.
Ah, okay. What if you were to just accept that stuff where it is? Like accept that it's down below the surface at the moment. Oh, that's okay. Because it knows what it is. Yeah, and just accepting that too. See, here's the thing, and you might like to experiment with this in the days and weeks ahead, is just going and talking to people. Maybe to attractive women or to unattractive women or to guys or to dogs or cats or whatever your chosen conversational companions are. And just noticing what your feelings are while you're talking. And if you're scared or anxious, that's okay. Just do that and notice it and say thank you to those feelings. Let yourself know at a deep level that it's okay to be you. It's okay to have your body and that it's okay to have the responses that you have, rather than trying to control and direct them. Because my sense is, if trying to control everything was going to work, probably would have worked by now. And the thing is, you've been developed over millions and millions of years for exactly this kind of situation. For talking to women, for talking to people, for engaging with people, for dealing with situations. You've been developed for millions of years to do that. You know how to do it. Like me, when I went through my catalog of drunken pickups all those years ago, it's like I was doing stuff that they're teaching on training courses, and I was never good at that stuff. So it's in there. It's already coded in there. We know how to do this stuff.
I always pick up when I'm not trying to pick up.
Yeah.
Whenever I go out, I'm like, yeah, pick up. I always do crap. I'm like, somewhere I'm just out with my friends, and I'm enjoying my night. Or I'll go to the bar, and I'll see someone there, just start talking, because that's not sure how I am.
Mm-hmm.
I always pick up that way, but whenever I'm out, and I'm like, with people and everything, like,
well, remember the first exercise we did? How did it feel when you had an intention in mind? And just for those guys who weren't here, I got the guys to do an exercise where they went and shook hands with someone they didn't know and had a conversation with them. But the mental mindset was, later on this evening, you want this person to lend you 50 quid. So you need to make them like you so that when it comes time to ask them for the 50 quid, they'll be willing to do it. So they did that, and they said it felt uncomfortable, it felt ingenuine, they felt anxious and all this sort of stuff. They said, okay, now just assume this person already likes you and you just want to go up and find out if they're the sort of person you want to get to know better. One of the things that we'll be exploring next weekend is what I call genuine qualification. Not about going, oh my God, you once went to Germany, I can't believe it, I've met my soulmate. But instead going, what's the stuff you genuinely like? What's the stuff you're genuinely interested in? What's the stuff that genuinely pisses you off? And that if someone's got those qualities, you really just don't want to get to know them, far less sleep with them. Because if you're qualifying someone genuinely, like when I go up and ask girls how old they are, that's a genuine qualification. I don't want to get in trouble by doing anything with anyone who's too young. So I want to find out how old they are. That's really important to me. They can feel the authenticity in my question. When I go up to girls in bars and say, hey guys, I feel like having a threesome tonight, they can feel the authenticity. Okay? I'm not saying you have to do that, but what I am saying is that when you get in touch with what really matters to you and start screening for that, people can feel it. People can feel it. Dave?
Okay. I'm fine. I don't really care what people think about me. I'm happy being what I'm going for in life. But there's certain times in life where there's certain things you need to do that you can't get by not doing them.
Mm.
And certain situations in life that to get through, well, like workplace, or living under someone's roof, I've got to do stuff. Also, sometimes, especially in workplace, as main example, it's almost like being yourself or self-expression is frowned down upon.
Sure.
And it's sort of like it makes other people uncomfortable, even just not saying anything, just being chilled out and unfazed by things at work. It's like people, I've had that a lot in my life, but yeah, I'll do the job I'm supposed to do. I'll do it more efficiently, whatever, I'll do it really well. But I'll do it my way, and it's working. I think people just get really uncomfortable with it.
Is there a question?
Say again.
Have you got a question around that?
Yeah, I mean, how would you say it'd be okay to sort of be true to yourself in that situation, whereas it's difficult to be yourself in a situation.
I think there's a long-term answer, medium to long-term answer, and there's a short-term answer. The medium to long-term answer is find work where you can be yourself. I mean, that's certainly what I've done. I've created a company where I can be who I am. I do very little corporate work these days, which sometimes brings a tear to my eye because I get offered huge amounts of money to do corporate work. But I don't like going and singing to someone else's tune. So I typically say no to it, unless they'll grant me complete free rein to do whatever I like, which most companies won't. There's one or two that will, but most companies won't. So the medium to long-term answer is I think it was Thoreau once said, don't accept a job where you have to change your clothes, where you have to dress differently to do it. I think what he meant by that is, be true to yourself. You know, we're not going to be around forever. That's the medium to long-term answer. The short-term answer is, you know, do what you got to do. If authentic expression to you means going into work with your trousers down your ankles, you may want to hold off on that until you've got the next job lined up, you know?
Sort of how it's going.
All right. Cool. Does that answer your question? Yeah. So recreate your reality. And part of that means changing your beliefs. And to my mind, part of that means being willing to shine. You know, when I first got into exploring this field of, you know, improving how I am with women and that sort of thing, I was seeing it all as techniques and things like that. And what started to emerge is that the guys who are naturally very good at this stuff are just being themselves, but they're being their best self. They're shining. They're not too bothered about what anyone else thinks of them. I met a guy in London who's, you know, just complete natural. And his attitude is, wherever I am, it's like, it's my party. It's my party wherever I am, whether I'm in a bar or a supermarket or in the street. It's my party. I can ask anyone anything that I want to. And I can get them to, you know, if I don't like their answer, I'll call them on it. And he's like, I'm not bothered about what anyone thinks of me. Because his basic core is, I know that I'm a good guy. And here's the thing. When you realize who you really are, that diamond, when you realize who you really are and that you don't need anything, there's something else you realize, which is your value is inherent. Okay? You are valuable. We never really, you know, there's a guy called Robert Diltz in the NLP community, done a lot of amazing work. And he identified a number of messages that people never, typically don't get when they're children. But the children who grow up to be really like the Richard Bransons of this world and people like that who are just incredibly motivated and achieve incredible things, the kind of messages they get are things like, you're valuable. Just for being you, you have value. And you're here for a reason. And you matter. Your opinion counts. And you don't have to do anything in order to be valuable. You are valuable anyway. So do what you're inspired to do. Because if you're doing stuff in order to make other people think that you're okay, or doing stuff in order to feel, you know, to assuage some guilt or something like that, it's second best. When you're doing stuff that you're inspired to do, it's because you're recognizing at a deep level that your value is inherent. When you recognize that your value is inherent, that radiates to people. That radiates to people. Other people can feel it. Other people can feel it. So that's almost kind of got me to where I wanted to get to tonight. But I've got a piece of paper here that says irresistible offer. I wanted to share an irresistible offer with you. Would it be okay if I spent just a couple of minutes talking about this program I've got coming up in 10 days? Or next, it's not even 10 days, it's next Friday. Would that be okay with you? Okay. I can't believe, I'll say this anyway. If I could show you a way that by spending 3 days now, you could save literally hundreds of hours of effort, fuck that. Basically, what it is the kind of ideas and concepts and things we've been exploring. We're going to be going through a 3-day process. Now, I've been able to touch on a bunch of the stuff, and I've got some handouts for you with the kind of things we've been exploring. But to really experience it and to go through that process of transformation is going to take 3 days. And it's going to be absolutely amazing. It's going to be like I think of it as a one-way valve. It's not like something, because I've been to some amazing courses over in the States where I got given a bunch of stuff that I then needed to go and work through and do and that sort of thing. It's not so much like that. It's a transformational process of connecting, really, first of all, giving you an experience of who you really are. Really connecting with that at a deep level. And then going and having what we might call outer game experiences that will reinforce that. So that will give you the experiences of having fun doing what you want to do, of figuring out the how behind a bunch of the concepts that we've been doing, and going through NLP change processes to work on an unconscious level. Because here's the thing, if there's only two big questions in terms of getting what you want. It's what do you want and what's been stopping you until now? And if the what's been stopping you is unconscious stuff, like at the belief level, or I'm not that kind of guy, or whatever it might be, that's the sort of stuff we're going to be playing with and tinkering with and changing to create rapid shifts, big shifts at a deep level. It's going to be an amazing time because we're going to be doing all kinds of cool stuff. But the process is all about being true to yourself, finding out who you really are and how you can express who you really are in a way that's inherently attractive. And one of the coolest things about it is while this is in this domain of life, you know, being successful with women, whatever that means to you, the results of this and the echoes of this are going to reverberate into all the different areas of your life. Because while you may have different areas of your life as one human being, and the changes you make in this area are going to have profound ripple effects in all the other areas. So, blah, 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 blah. I love this. Here's some NLP hypnotic language. A year from now, when you're experiencing the kinds of success you want, not only with women, but in every area of your life, you'll look back on your decision to be part of this program as a turning point in your life. It's funny because the hypnotic language, I'm quite well known in the NLP world for hypnotic language patterns and using hypnotic language, but it's a lot more fun when you've practiced it and it just comes naturally. So one of the things I'm going to be offering tonight, oh, by the way, the course is going to be here in this room, I think, in this room. The regular price for this is going to be at least $11.97, but the price for it for this time, because we're filming it, we've got a film, not just a single cam that Sharon's been manning for us tonight, but we've got a film crew coming in to do it because we're turning it into a product. So the price is going to be $6.97. Whoever's that is probably didn't hear the announcement at the beginning about what I was going to do with the phone, so go for it, Sharon. It's $6.97. There's also a 3-for-price-of-2 deal. So if there's 3 of you guys that want to come, you can get 3 places for the price of 2. Or if you want to bring 2 other people and get them to pay, you can get your place free, whichever works for you best. But in addition, for people who are here tonight, you'll get a copy of there's a thing we've got, which is one of our best-selling products called the Hypnotic Language Masterclass, which is teaching you how to use hypnotic language. I'm not huge on using hypnotic language specifically to get women into bed or whatever, but I think being able to use your language skillfully and to be able to use language to guide people's thinking in a certain direction and that sort of thing, just learning that skill set gets you to, you know, focus your thoughts and focus your communications even more powerfully. So you'll get that and a deck of Ericksonian hypnosis cards, which are our best-selling product. They're cards for teaching you hypnotic language, so I'm throwing that in. And so it's because I'm filming it for a DVD, and there's places for, we've got about 10 places left, I think. Do you know how many we've got left? We've got about 10 places left. Oh, this is the other thing, and this is, in a way, the most important thing. If you're committed to doing it, if you really think this is something you want to do and it feels right to you, then I'm committed to finding a payment plan that'll work for you. So if you really want to do it, I'm not so bothered about when the money shows up. I want to have people there who are really into it and can have that experience and get the most from it. So if that's something that's interesting to you, I'll be here at the end, which is now. So thank you for your attention. Just before we wrap up, any questions, comments, anything you want to know more about? Or
I think you've been around before.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. And once we've packed up, I was going to go over to Fat Cats, just sort of just across the road here, and have some drinks and that sort of. Yeah, we've got a whole bunch of products on the back table. I don't have any attraction products, but Sharon, who's very attractive, will be dealing with any product stuff, anything you want or anything you're interested in back there. We've got a ton of stuff on hypnosis, on NLP, on happiness, and, you know, just how to be, you know, how to experience the kind of life that you want. So, yeah. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you for your attention. Has this been useful?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, cool. Thank you for your attention. I'll see you, those of you who